Namaskar. On behalf of Manoj Ladva and Team India Inc. and the Natya STEM Dance Company Bangalore, I extend to you a hearty welcome to this section of India Global Week 2020. Dance is a reflection of life. In fact, in India, we believe that the very process of creation, of sustenance, and of destruction is seen as the cosmic cycle of life, personified in Indian iconography and symbology in the form of Shiva, the cosmic dancer, and the presiding deity of the stage, Ganesha, the elephant-headed god, who stands at the threshold of change. Today, we are all facing disruptive times, a very creative time, challenging times, and we invite to our viewers auspiciousness as we stand on this threshold of change. With that intent of inviting positivity, the first piece on tonight's repertoire is Tandav. This piece is inspired by the sculptural splendor, the architectural beauty and iconography of the temples of South and Central India. What is unique about this piece is that every movement that you see, the movement stock, is taken from a 2,000-year-old book on dramaturgy called the Natya Shastra. You will see, ladies and gentlemen, that although the movement stock comes to us from centuries ago, it is still very contemporary in its presentation, in the optic it offers. And that is testimony to the timelessness of Indic thought, of Indian philosophy, and Indian dance. This piece is choreographed by legendary guru and choreographer, Dr. Maya Rao, performed by the Natya and STEM Dance Company. Nirbhar, self-reliant, it is hugely resilient, constantly evolving, and very creative. This diversity of thought is reflected in the Indian dance ethos. I'll tell you why. India has about 8 classical dance forms, over 5 known martial art forms, and a few hundred folk and ritualistic forms. As I talk to you, we're still finding out more that you probably don't know about now. So how does one define the Indian dance heritage in a day? We are going to make this possible by showcasing one of each genre. The classical forms of Kathak and Bharatanatyam, the operatic tradition of Yakshagana, folk forms from across Western and Northern India, martial art forms from Eastern India, all merging into an identity called Bharat. The next piece, ladies and gentlemen, that we have for you is Unity in Diversity.
Namaskar, everyone. It's such a great pleasure. It's an honor to talk to a friend who's also such an eminent artist, Madhu Natraj. Thank you, Madhu, for this lovely conversation that we're going to have on art and what it means to all of us today.
Namaskar, and thank you so much, Vikram. It's both an honor and a complete delight always to be in conversation with you.
Thank you. And so in the context of the new presentation that you and company is doing, I thought we'll talk a little about things which we've always spoken, in over coffee, over conversations. As an artist, are you always very conscious of the fact that you are the inheritor of a legacy, that's come down not just a few years or centuries, but over 2,000, 3,000 years? The Bharata's Natya Shastra, which was composed so many centuries ago, is something that you as an artist is embodying almost on a daily basis. So what sort of, what does that make you feel, and what kind of responsibility does that put on you as an artist?
Gosh, I think now it sounds huger after you put it that way. But yes, I think every single day as artists, at least I am very conscious of the fact that I am setting a precedent, and that I have to have the humility to know that the art is bigger than me. It always will be, always larger, more encompassing, and that we are all receptacles. Yes, some people call us custodians of culture. But I think we are basically storytellers who are taking forward this tradition and adding to it our angle of, the socio-political scenario around us, what is happening as artists. Dance has, as you know, always evolved, Vikram. And even if you look at the Natya Shastra, even Bharat Muni has a humility to say, thus far I have written, but, dancers will take this forward to four different parts of India and make it their own.
Wow.
Of course, I'm not saying it verbatim, but so that of course is there. And as you know, there's a double legacy here also with Mayaji.
Yes. What I was going to ask next about the are you acutely conscious of the fact that you've been so fortunate to be both the daughter and the disciple of probably one of India's greatest Kathak maestros, Dr. Maya Rao, who's had a legacy of her own from Shambhu Maharaji, and a whole legacy there of Kathak in its most authentic and original form. So how much of that does that weigh on your slender shoulders?
Yeah, that also weighs heavy. But, fortunately, I had my guru and my mother was a very, very open-minded person. So even if an 18-year-old walked into her class, she said, don't have blinkers on. The same kind of respect you have for tradition, for innovation as well. And I think just going back a little bit to the point we were making the last question that you asked me, that tradition can't be pickled, right? It has to evolve. And I think when purists talk about, this is how this was done by so-and-so dancer or Mayaji, etc., and look at what Madhu is doing. So the ready repartee would always be from my own guru that you have to learn dance and then make it your own. Even as an artist, when she taught me, she would teach me a movement, and then she says, now make it your own. And also she would customize it for each of us. For example, I have a taller personality, so there's a shorter dancer. She would say, haath idhar rakho ya idhar rakho, depending on the angularity you need, the anshubhi you need. And when I took to also contemporary dance, as you know, I have a dual identity as a Kathak and contemporary dancer. She was really, really happy, that I took to it, and she loved the contemporary work we did. And also knew that she had a ready reckoner in me. Each time she said she wants to publish a book or do something, we'd all team up, we all of our students, and make it happen. So it does weigh heavy, Vikram, and I think we all have to prove ourselves doubly, stronger. But I would like to put this on record, and anybody can come up and challenge me on this. In my whole lifetime, my mother and my guru never wrote a single letter to anybody asking them to take me into a performance or to give me a chance, an opportunity.
Wow.
You know, wow. So I was probably her 400th student, and there were 500 after me, maybe, you know.
Wow.
I mean, just to give you an idea. So, but what I did get is that I learned so much through osmosis. So I really felt I was, you know, part of the Guru Shrishya Parampara in the real sense, because from the time you got up till you slept and more, you observe your Guru. You know, you look at how she deals with the situation, how she walks, how she conducts herself. And for me, dance is a womb memory, you know. So I think, I feel hugely blessed that I was born to a woman like her and that she was my guru. I feel even if I wasn't born to her, I would have found her as my guru.
I'm sure. and someone like Mayaji, with whom I've, you know, been fortunate to have so many lovely conversations with you and her over dinner several times. We've always spoken about this whole aspect that, you know, all our art forms, dance in particular, while, you know, they may have predated to several centuries back, there is that element of contemporariness, there's that element of timelessness in it. They're as relevant as the artist would want to make it relevant to contemporary issues. So what are your thoughts about our art forms not being frozen in time, you know, like a monument in some archaeological site, but there's an element of timelessness despite it referencing, you know, historical themes or Puranic themes and so on, which people may think is not relevant today. So what do you have to say about that, Madhu?
That's such a great question, Vikram, you know, because there are so many different ideas and concepts that come into play here. And just take it one step at a time. Today, in fact, the company performed a piece called Tanda, which takes all its movement stock from the Natya Shastra, which is 2,000 years old. And you look at it, it looks as contemporary as a piece that could have been created today, you know. And also, and our Institute of Choreography, like Mayaji said, that, you know, you do your Puranic work and then you do historical themes, etc. You also do your Sanskrit theme, you know, based on the Natya Shastra, the precepts of the Natya Shastra. But then finally, you have to choose a contemporary concept, something that bothers you as an artist of today. It could be dowry a few years ago. It could be, you know, a communal harmony. It could be the way a certain sector of society is treated. So, you know, she was very particular that you react and respond as an artist to what is happening around you, because that's what artists did in the past too. And you are
conscience keepers of society.
You're so right, because when you look at your books, and that's why I think Ma was so fond of you, not just because you're so adorable and such a brilliant mind, and she just loved creative individuals around her, and your book is what got us together. And I think Goharjan, my name is Goharjan, and I think Gohar personifies what we're talking about, you know, that she stayed relevant. A woman who spoke so many languages and
adapted to new technology.
And admit technology. So she could be as comfortable with technology and with the Europeans as she was with her Maharajas and Gurus, etc. And of course, the balance, the work-life balance that one keeps talking about as artists, for us, I think that line has eroded long ago. So,
<I know. laughs>
and also, you know, I so wish, Vikram, that Ma was here to read your Savarkar book, which is such a delight. Thank you for bringing that out to the world.
Thank you, Madhu. Thank you. And I still remember, I think that was the initial bond where we spoke so much about also Mayaji's work with the Devdasis of Mysore, where she had gone and interviewed them. And that was such a revelation, the kind of conversations we had. And speaking about artists, I think adapting to technology, look at how sitting in the same city, we are having to do this over Zoom, given the conditions that we are in today as a society. The other thing that I want to probably touch upon is the fact that I think there was someone in the Gramophone Company, you know, the report you spoke about Goharjan, where they came to record her. There were these reports that people would put in where they said India is such a fascinating country where almost every few kilometers, the changes, the food styles changes, I mean, the and naturally the art forms also change. So in what is a country which is a conglomerate of so many different cultures, traditions, languages, dialects, people, customs, natures, and all of that, we are still holding on together as a nation, you know, culturally. I mean, people could always argue we became a nation state or so on politically after the British, but culturally, right from the Vishnu Puran, we've always been deemed as one, you know, a geographic, sacred geography, a cultural entity. So as an artist who's, of course, your training might be in one particular art form because one cannot train in all art forms. But then this whole fact that there are multiplicities of art forms, particularly in dance, 8 classical dance forms, so many folk art forms, martial arts, all of that. So how does that, how does one view this diversity? Is it a handicap for India, or is it this unity in diversity that we keep harping all the time, right, from our school essays that we wrote, is that an advantage for India?
I think it is an advantage for India because I feel that, you know, when we accept diversity, when we accept distinction, then we are open to change. And I think this time, this COVIDian times, the pandemic has taught us one thing. It is that we can't predict anything, you know, and also that... you know, to be fearless about the future. Take one day at a time. This is what our, all our philosophies, especially our Hindu Buddhist philosophies, talk about, being in the present moment. And I think when we are used to so much diversity, we are open to transformation, to change. I mean, we should be, of course. That is the other side of the spectrum, the other side of the mirror, as we all know. I think that's what makes us special, and that's what makes us, you're right, so difficult to explain to someone when you say, I'm Indian, what does that mean? You know, as like as you said, 20 kilometers from Bangalore, the cuisine starts to change, the weave starts to change, the way a sari is worn has changed, you know, dance forms. So, I mean, over 500-600 dance forms in India alone. And somebody was talking the other day about, you know, the whole of the Western world is so like clued into ballet. Why doesn't it happen in India? I said, the whole of the Western world has one classical form called ballet. In India alone, we have 8 classical forms. Each one as evolved and developed and refined as ballet is. So, you know, I think we hold a huge legacy on our shoulders, Vikram, I think, which is great. But I think I wish people were a little more open to innovation in our country now in the 21st century.
I think that's such a wonderful, you know, thought that you brought about the diversity and how it can actually be an asset for India if we would want to look at it that way. And as somebody, you know, who's fused the ancient art, the traditional art form of Kathak with contemporary dance, and your work, your body of work on that being so rich, I think it's work like this which is most relevant today in today's world, where people are grappling to find answers for contemporary issues using our traditional knowledge, traditional you know, thought processes. So thank you so much, Madhu, for this very, very interesting and enlightening conversation. And I think as artists continue to readapt and reinvent ourselves, we'll find new avenues. Not only to you know, showcase what we have for the rest of the world, but also catch up like this, perhaps in the online space much more than in person, even though we live in the same city.
Thank you so much, Vikram. It is an honor talking to you. I wish you could be with us at our studio right now, having a filter coffee and having this conversation. But thank God for technology at this moment as we talk about tradition and truly a meeting and coexistence of the two. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Madhu.
The acknowledgement of the polarities, the opposites, is another interesting philosophy in Indian dance. Shiva, seen as the masculine presence, and the feminine power, Shakti. If he is the mountain, she is the river. If he is the universal spirit, she is flesh and blood, Prakriti. yin and yang, positive, negative, lasya, tandava, call it what you may, but in the merging of the two is the essence of Indian dance. The next piece that you watch personifies this philosophy. We begin with a very interesting interactive multimedia piece where art and technology meet. The dancers interact with imagery and create a Panchabhuta Mandala, the five elements, earth, water, fire, air, and the most metaphysical of them all, space or ether. After this, the dancers go into a piece called Ushas, which is an obeisance to both the goddess of dawn, Ushas, and to Surya, the sun god. This piece represents the attributes, the qualities of India seen in these entities: strength, self-reliance, and energy. This piece is unique because it brings together various movement disciplines from India. The martial art forms of Kalaripayattu from Kerala, Chau from Odisha, from Jharkhand and West Bengal, and Thangtha from Manipur, merging with motifs of Hatha Yoga and contemporary Indian dance. Ladies and gentlemen, we have for you Mandala, the cosmic floor plan of the universe, and Ushas.
Thank you.
Journeyed from the Natya Shastra to various parts of India, looking at the various movement disciplines. Also, these forms resonate the socio-cultural evolution of each of these regions through history. So, dancers also are receptacles, chroniclers of time and space. Dance cannot exist in isolation is our belief. India has inspired many, but has also been open to being inspired. This cross illumination between various fields is very, very important for any kind of growth of an art form or of a philosophy of a nation. This next piece that we bring to you is the perfect echo and link to this idea. Kathak is a dance form that evolved in the temple precincts of Uttar Pradesh and Rajasthan. Over time, these traveling bards took stories of the Indian gods and goddesses with them. We have had many invasions, and with the influx of iconoclastic rulers, these dancers went underground and their ghungroos were silenced. But they reinvented themselves and re-emerged from the temple to the courts. They resurfaced as court dancers in the courts of Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh. With benign rulers such as Akbar the Great, Jahangir, and then Wajid Ali Shah, this dance form took on a beautiful Sufi Persian element into its stride. Today, Kathak is a beautiful amalgam of both the Hindu and Islamic cultures and of many influences. In fact, the piece that you're going to see next, Sankalan, which means an amalgam, a union, brings together Kathak and a dance form which is inspired by it and practiced in Europe, flamenco. They say that gypsies traveling through Rajasthan, Afghanistan, Turkey, Romania, Spain, took this form with them. And being artists, there was an exchange of ideas, and these two forms mirror each other till today. It is a belief of our company that dance, philosophy, knowledge, and technology cannot be bound by barriers that are geographical, political, or racial. Ladies and gentlemen, Sankalan also brings to you interesting conversations or jugalbandis between the dancers. We have for you now Sankalan.
Tak, tak, tak. Madhu, firstly, a huge thank you. That was such a heart-rending and beautiful performance. It was scintillating, it was touching, it was beautiful. It was poetry in motion, in other words. I think the way you and your team have gone about the journey of depicting India, Atmanirbhar India, or Atmanirbhar Bharat, from tradition to modernity, was just something that touched the soul. It was truly poetic, movement in motion, and I absolutely loved it. So on behalf of everyone who's watching, I know that that would have given us some remedy and relief in these really interesting times, and that was just such a beautiful and passionate and compassionate performance that really wanted to thank you for that amazing effort that your team and everyone has done coming together in a time like COVID as well. So deeply, deeply appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Umang. Very, very kind words, and coming from you means a lot more. And on behalf of the company, we thank you.
No, thanks a lot. I think the pleasure was all ours of just watching that beautiful performance. Madhu, I'd like to ask you, at the end, society goes through its highs, lows, its transformation over the ages. But at the end of it all, what's left in society, or you can judge the quality of a society by the quality of the arts. What does today stand for in terms of, what does art really stand for in today's transformative journey for us as a society, as we are going through some really unprecedented times?
I think what the arts teach us to do, Umang, and that is something that is never really acknowledged in a society unless there is a crisis or otherwise, is that it teaches you to be fearless, it teaches you to be spontaneous, and it teaches you to be in the present moment. Because when you are immersed in an art form, whether it's my sadhana with dance, or it might be a musician, they might be an artist, or they might be a writer, the very fact that whatever happens around you, you dip into your oasis of riyaz or practice regardless is like meditation. And when you are practicing your art, you're in the present moment. And it teaches us to walk into our studios or into our places of creation. The moment you leave your chappals behind, you have to leave all problems, egos, etc. behind, is what we are we train, but many iterations, it just comes into our DNA in a sense. And also the fact that, to be fearless, that change is a constant. And I think the time, these COVIDian times have taught us and have also splintered the psychological barrier against change for most people, isn't it? We've all seen that. And we've become more resilient. And everybody turned to the arts. You know, whether it was to read a book, watch concerts, artists were so generous at this time sharing their work worldwide, or it was to watch movies or whatever. I mean, the arts are an immersive oasis. So I think also when you are, immerse yourself or engage with the arts, you learn to be more spontaneous. So it's not about constantly following a mob. So you're thinking out of the box. At the same time, you know how to adhere. So I think that's the importance of engaging with the arts, very less, is spoken about it. And it's also, even otherwise, it's a strong undercurrent of our society, and you're so right when you say that when you look at the state of the arts in our society, you can gauge how much they've evolved. And in that sense, India has always been very kind to its artists, because the patronage is two-way, right? So it's engagement, immersion, but as in today's language, with this stimulus response, there has to be a connection. And I think as Indians, whether it was in ancient times or modern times, we connect to our arts.
Well, that's such a beautiful answer. I think what I was reflecting on when you were talking was three things that stuck with me. One is the arts are an immersive oasis. I'd never thought of that. The second thing that you said is that it really represents fearlessness. And the third thing that you said, as society evolves, it goes through this transformation and this adaptability. And when I'm going to try and make this a little difficult for you now, right? If, as business leaders and people who run companies or are involved with economic decisions, a lot of what you just said is what we are telling our teams, our communities, that here's a time that we need to be fearless. We need to be highly entrepreneurial. We need to transform. We need to adapt. We need to thrive in this adaption, because only when we can change and constantly adapt ourselves is when we can truly become a company that has been built to last. As an artist, if you had to give advice to the business community on your core learnings, because what you just said really resonated with me, but if you had to give advice to corporations, to CEOs, no pressure there, but if you had to go about that journey of just sharing with us in a time like this, which is highly unprecedented in the last 100 years, what would your guidance to us as a society be? And I'd love for you to share that with a correlation with the arts.
That is a toughie, Umang, but a wonderful question. I love that challenge and I'll try my best. So I feel as Indians, first of all, let's start from a common platform. We are all, whether corporate honchos or artists or, people in different industries, we are all a very, very resilient bunch. And I think you and I have had this conversation also, that we firefight every single day like nobody else in the world can, living in India and working. So resilience is something that we've already taken on as a partner for life. And the arts, like if you look at Kathak by itself, I feel if I am a Kathak dancer today, and it's a tradition that has been passed on for thousands of years, I feel I'm a receptacle, of that journey of resilience, because it has paced from lack of patronage to invasions to complete isolation, and reemerged, reinvented, recreated itself from a temple form to a court form to a to a proscenium form too, as you saw in the piece, the Kathak and Flamenco, that it is India, it is Kathak that inspired Flamenco, and we still mirror each other. So I'd like to say that behind all this talk about resilience and, firefighting, resourcefulness, there is one core attribute that we all have to have and nurture, and that's creativity. I really think creativity is a 21st century life skill. And this time has taught us that it is this attribute that we tap into, then we reinvent, we realign and recreate, you know, regenerate. But to be able to do that, we have to first acknowledge that each of us is very creative. And definitely, I think that is a quality, whether I'm an artist or a person like you, who in my mind is already very, very creative and doesn't acknowledge it, is something we all have to nurture. And also this whole concept of, so when you say creativity, in India, we have this concept of Shakti. And one scholar once gave me a beautiful definition of Shakti, because people say it's energy or, you know, omnipotence, etc. And he said, Shakti is the capable will. I'll leave you with that.
Wow. I mean, I was so blown by that answer, and it reminded me of, I think, a conversation we had years ago wherein, if I, you know, I asked you what is create, you know, if you weren't creating, what would you rather be doing? And I remember, I think you said something to the lines of, if I, creativity is my reason for existence. And if I wasn't creating, I'd rather not be alive, right? And I think I absolutely love that answer, because I never realized how artists are constantly evolving their art form. And the piece that you referenced around the Kathak and the flamenco coming together reminded me of a huge opportunity. We live in a globalized world. And, you know, potentially this is a time where we as India can probably reinvent ourselves, be a whole lot more creative, and use this as an opportunity to reinvent and redefine the world order in so many ways. So how do you look at, Madhu, one last question, if I may, how do you look at the confluence between art and technology? Because, you know, there's the left brain and the right brain. There's the art and the science. There's the diversity and the, you know, the complete laser focus. They're completely, you know, diametrically opposite concepts. But what you just showed was, I would have never imagined two diametrically opposite dance forms like flamenco and Kathak really driving that influence of globalization. So how does that art and science really, or art and technology, or the left brain and the right brain really come together for you in this journey?
Umang, I, as you know, have a dual identity as a Kathak and a contemporary dancer, because I believe in, I live this philosophy of coexisting with tradition and modernity. And I think each of us as Indians does that every single day in our lives. And therefore, I feel that to me, as an artist, it's important that I'm relevant. Not to find a convoluted route to get there, but I really feel organically that I'm an artist who has lived in the 20th and now 21st century. Yes, I have carried so much knowledge that has come down to us from generations, but we have to be relevant and we have to inspire and be inspired constantly. And so if you remember the second, third piece we saw, Ushas with the mandala formation, where, you know, dancers use technology. This was a piece created way back in 2004. This was one of India's first pieces with interactive multimedia technology to offer the idea of the Panchabhutas, the five elements coming together. And to me, I really believe that creativity is about having one stream that you're very familiar with, that you are, you know, as you say, you know, you're needed in dough sort of in that. It could be business acumen for some, artistry for some. And a second line that you don't know much about at all. So it could be technology. I'm still very technologically challenged, but I have a wonderful team of artists who works to bring this together. When you create a groove and the water flows into both, I think that's a creative moment, you know. And similarly, this whole concept of, since we are celebrating India, let me bring in some Indian philosophy. When we talk about the left and right brain, it is beautifully shown in iconography and philosophy as the Ardhanarishvar. The right side of the body is Shiv, or the side that is more, managerial, etc. And the left is Shakti, creativity. So, but of course, the right brain manages the left, and the left side. There itself, there is balance. So whether it's, as you will see in one of the pieces I've spoken about that, whether it's yin, yang, earth, sky, feminine, masculine, you know, the thing is, unless there is balance, we really don't have anything. And I really feel that this confluence that we must have between technology, various fields and arts, I believe there has to be cross-illumination. And you believe it too, otherwise why would you call an artist, a dancer to come and speak at a business conference, right? You believe in cross-illumination. We are like water, Umang, you and I and all of us. You know, you put us in any situation and we are like, put us in a bottle, in a matka, in a tin, we'll find our equilibrium. Left and right.
Wow. You know, there was one thing that you said so early on, and of course, contrasted so beautifully towards the end on the right and the left brain between Shakti and creativity. But you said something around organically, we have to be relevant. And we have to keep transforming ourselves to drive that relevance. And I think, you know, when I closed my eyes thinking about that, reflecting, it could have been an economist saying it, it could have been a business leader saying it. I would have never bet $1,000 that it would have been an artist who would tell me this, because it is so true. And that is who we are as a society deep down. Like you rightly said, the Indian tradition is so rich and has been so kind to the arts. Madhu, I know we could go on for hours, but it has been an absolute pleasure. Not only have I been enriched by watching the performance, but I think the last 10 minutes when I've been speaking to you has enriched me furthermore. Thank you for that gift and wish you and your team all the very best. Stay safe in these unprecedented times and God bless.
Thank you so much, Umang. An honor indeed to talk to you. Namaskar.
And with that, we come to an end of this section of the India Global Week 2020. Heartfelt thanks to Manoj Ladwa and team India Inc., Umang Bedi of Daily Hunt, and all the wonderful artists that you saw perform today. Please do check in the credits to look at their names. And we hope to meet you again, virtually or otherwise. Namaskar.